Hello, and welcome to our sixth and final video tutorial on how to read and use VFR sectional charts as unmanned aerial system, or UAS, operators. This series of videos is brought to you by AmericaView, in partnership with the College of Natural Resources and Environment at Virginia Tech, the Virginia Cooperative Extension, and GeoTED UAS. My name is Daniel Cross, and I'll guide you through this tutorial. In this video, we'll take a look at topographic features not included in the legend, how to find the coordinates for any location, I'll give you a few tips on how to read a sectional, and then we'll do a preliminary flight plan for a sample UAS mission. The first topic for this video will be elevation. Over on the edge of the map, we have a colored scale which shows us the color gradients used to display the different elevation changes on the map. These will be different for each sectional, starting at the lowest elevation and going to the highest in each coverage area. On the San Francisco sectional, the lowest elevation is sea level, which is light green, and the highest is 14,491 feet MSL, that's this dark brown. Here in the Sierra Nevadas, we have a full range of colors that indicate a large difference in elevation. Also, there are topographic lines, which are used to mark places where there are drastic changes in elevation. The normal contour interval is 500 feet, and these are marked with their elevation. But in some areas, there will be intermediate contours every 250 feet or auxiliary contours every 100 feet. The closer together the contour lines, the steeper the terrain. Very flat areas will not have any contours, only the color gradient. Finally, each latitude-longitude grid box contains bold blue numbers which mark the highest elevation, be it terrain or man-made. This number is in hundreds of feet MSL. An example, in this grid square, the highest point is 12,900 feet MSL. The next item are congested areas, which are marked on the map with these bright yellow areas. Congested areas are built up, highly populated areas such as towns, cities, or large universities. We are allowed to fly in congested areas, but it may be more difficult since we are not allowed to fly over other people. Now, let's talk about one of the most important elements of a map, and that's the coordinate system. This is something that you will encounter more than once on your Part 107 exam. Coordinate systems are how you communicate the location of something on the map. Sectionals use degrees and minutes as the units of measure for latitude and longitude. On the map, each half degree, both latitude and longitude, are marked with this grid of black lines. Each full degree is marked with black numbers, whereas half degrees are not. The small black ticks on the lines of latitude and longitude measure minutes, and as you would expect, there are 60 minutes in one degree. Now, let's find the coordinates for Gordon Airport. First, let's find out how far north it is. We will start by counting up from this line of latitude, which is 42.5 degrees. We know this because the next line up is 43 degrees. So we will start counting from 30 minutes. This means that the latitude is 42 degrees and 48 minutes north. Next, let's find out how far west it is. To do this, we will start counting from the 102 degree line. That puts it at 102 degrees and 10 minutes west. So the coordinates for Gordon Airport are 42 degrees, 48 minutes north, by 102 degrees, 10 minutes west. You may also get questions on the Part 107 exam that are the reverse of this, where you are given the coordinates and asked to find the name of the site. Furthermore, the FAA sometimes uses decimal degrees instead of degrees in minutes. If you need to measure latitude and longitude using decimal degrees, use the minute ticks to estimate 1/100ths of a degree instead of minutes. In our example using Gordon, the airport's coordinates in decimal degrees are 42.8 degrees by negative 102.2 degrees. Now that you have seen a lot of VFR sectionals, you've probably noticed they are often quite noisy. By that I mean there is so much information on them that it can be difficult to interpret what you're looking at. My suggestion for overcoming this is to mentally filter out most of that data and only focus on one subject at a time. I like to start by looking for regular airspaces, then I move on to airports, then polygonal special use airspaces, MTRs, obstacles, and other potential hazards. Take your time on each subject, one at a time, and remember that even though you're looking at a flat surface, there is a lot of 3D information being presented, and you will often run into areas where there are many layers of different types of airspace overlaying one another. As a capstone to this series of videos, let's put everything we have learned together and run through a preliminary UAS flight planning session using the St. Louis sectional. To start with, let's say that we're planning a habitat mapping mission along the northern portion of the Saline Creek here in western Kentucky. The first thing we are going to look for is any controlled normal use airspace in our mission area. Right off the bat, we can see there is Class G airspace right up to 1,200 feet AGL. There's some Class E airspace that starts at 700 feet AGL, about 5 miles away, and some Class D airspace just inside that, around Campbell Army Airfield. But those are too far away to affect our mission. Then, we'll look for special use airspace, and right away several things jump out at us. First off, it looks like we might be in two restricted areas, R3702 Alpha and Bravo. Also, we might be in the Campbell 1 MOA. So now that we know this, let's check the special use airspace tables to look up R3702 Alpha and Bravo, as well as the Campbell 1 MOA, to see if those areas will affect our flight at all. First on the list is R3702 Alpha, which starts at the surface and goes to 10,000 feet. So we're definitely in that restricted area. However, we can see that it's only activated by NOTAM 24 hours in advance. Assuming the mission we are planning is happening in less than 24 hours, and there are no NOTAMs regarding R3702 Alpha, we are in good shape. Then, we'll look at R3702 Bravo, and it starts at 10,000 feet MSL, which means it's way above where we want to fly, and we don't even need to worry about it at all. Now, we'll pan down to the MOAs to check out Campbell 1. This MOA starts at 500 feet AGL and goes up to 10,000 feet MSL. It's active daily from 0700 to 2000, or 7 a.m. to 8 p.m. Since we cannot fly higher than 400 feet AGL, we are not technically going to be flying in the MOA. However, we now know that we need to be extra vigilant for high-speed military aircraft maneuvering just above our mission area. Now, let's move back to Saline Creek. The next thing we look for are any obstacles, such as this cluster of towers, but it's too far away to be an issue. There's also this electrical transfer line over here, but again, it's too far away to concern us. If you're using SkyVector or a similar site or app, we can turn on the DROTAMs to make sure there are no other UAS operations we should know about. This also tells us that we're not going to be accidentally flying into any of the new drone no-fly zones. We might also want to see if there are any TFRs that SkyVector knows about in the area. And it looks like there are none, but this could change. Many TFRs are assigned to VIPs, such as congresspeople or the president. That wraps up our sample planning session. Essentially, what we've done here is to establish that we can legally fly our survey of Saline Creek. Also, we've identified some potential hazards, and that will allow us to mitigate some of the risk. And this brings us to the end of our series on how to read sectionals for UAS operators. I hope this has been informational, and we wish you the best of luck in your unmanned aerial endeavors. Thank you for joining us. And as always, fly safe.